The general linear model, or GLM, is a mathematical framework for expressing relationships among variables. You can test the linear relationships between a numerical dependent variable and any combination of categorical or continuous independent variables. In a basic general linear model, you try to predict a dependent variable, which we'll often call y, as an equation. It's the sum of the average value, which we can call mu, plus any of the main effects, we might call those A and B, plus any of their interactions. So the interaction between A and B, plus some random error. And the random error might be specific to a group. So don't worry if this doesn't make any sense. The best way to learn about linear models is to simulate data where you know exactly how their variables are related, and then analyze the simulated data and see where the parameters that you built into the simulation show up in the analysis. So let's start with a simple linear model that has a single categorical factor with two levels. Say we're predicting reaction times for congruent and incongruent trials in a Stroop task for a single participant. We need to know about the average reaction time this person has, and then also the average difference between their congruent or incongruent trials, which is the size of the effect. We predict that congruent trials will be faster than incongruent trials. We'll need to represent the groups, or these categories of congruent and incongruent, with a coding. And we need to know how much variability is there between trials. What's the error term? Every trial won't have the exact same response. People might be a little bit faster on some trials than others due to random fluctuations in attention or learning about the task, or maybe fatigue. So we have to add an error term to each trial that's sampled from a distribution. We learned about sampling distributions last week, and this will be sampled from a normal distribution. So our first task is to describe the parameters of your data. So how many trials are there per group? We'll call it the N per group. And let's have 100 trials. We also need to set this mu, or the grand average. So on average, our person's reaction time is 800 milliseconds. We also need to know the effect of category. So how much faster are they on congruent than incongruent trials? And let's say that's 50 milliseconds. Now, how much variation is there from trial to trial? It'll be random, but come from a normal distribution with a mean of 0, of course, and a standard deviation of 100. So we'll set the error SD to 100. This is a number you get from pilot data or the literature. Now we also need to represent our trial types with coding. You might have heard of dummy coding, where you code one category as 0, your reference category, and the other one as 1. What we're going to use is effect coding, where you code one category as negative 0.5 and the other category as 0.5. So they're one unit apart, one positive and one negative. They represent that you take half the effect and add it to the mean for one group, and you take half the effect and subtract it from the mean for another group. My favorite way to represent this is to set up a variable for your category and make that equal to a vector that's named. So we say congruent trials here. If they're congruent, they're going to be a little bit faster. So the reaction time will be lower. So we're going to set that to negative 0.5 for congruent trials. And for incongruent trials, we predict they'll be a little bit faster. So we'll set those as positive 0.5. So we can run all of this. Let's create a table. We'll call it dat and construct it with the tibble function. The first thing we want to do is create a column for trial type. We want to have 100 congruent trials and 100 incongruent trials. So we can use the rep function And then names of trial types. So this will give us the name values for that vector. You can see it's just congruent and incongruent. We want to repeat each of those n per group times each, so 100 times each. Can run that, have a look at dat, and it's 100 congruent, 100 incongruent trials. Once we've set up our very basic table, we can now pipe this to mutate and set up some more variables. We need the effect coded version of the trial type. I call that trialtype.e. So it has the same name as the word version, but has .e to remind me that it's effect coded. This is a numeric coding that we're going to use in our equation later. So we can get that from trial types. There's a function called recode that will let us take the value in the column trial type and recode it based on a rule. If we have our variable set up like this, we can do it in a special way, but if you don't have it set up like that, you can just copy in. The rule is congruent will equal -0.5 and incongruent will equal +0.5. If you have a variable set up like this, you can use the shortcut triple bang, which just means expand this into that. I like to do it this way because then you can't get out of sync. You define your trial types and they're coding in one place, and then you just use it later in your equation. And when you want to change something about your coding, you only need to change it once. So let's run that. And now we have -0.5 for all of the congruent trials, +0.5 for all of the incongruent trials. Again, you could type this in directly in a lot shorter way, but it's less easy than to change it later when you want to change minor things, then you would need to change numbers in many different places. Now we also need to simulate the error. Remember, the error term is random. It's different for every trial, but we can describe its distribution. It comes from a distribution that's normal with a mean of 0 and standard deviation of 100. So let's set up the error term and simulate it our norm. Now we can use this shortcut, nrow dot. The dot represents the data frame that was piped into this mutate function. And this just gives us our norm with as many values as there are rows in this table. You don't need to know how many there are, so if you change things like the n per group up here, this will just change itself. Now the error term always has a mean of 0 and the standard deviation that we set. So let's run that and have a look. So we have each trial, its numeric representation, and the error term. If we run this again, we'll get different error terms, but they'll be from the same distribution. Now all we need to do is calculate the reaction time. So the reaction time is the mean reaction time. Remember, we set it up here, 800 milliseconds, plus the effect. Now, the congruent and incongruent trials are 50 milliseconds different. So if the mean's 800, the congruent trials should be 775, and the incongruent trials should be 825. So we need to multiply this effect by the trial type and add it to mu. So here we have our effect that comes from up here, multiplied by our effect coded trial type. And we also need to add in our error term. Now we can run this again. And here's our full data set simulated. For each trial, we know what trial type it is. We've created an error term, which will be different every time we run this code. And we have a simulated reaction time. I recommend to always, always, once you've simulated some data, to plot it. So let's use ggplot and set our aesthetic mapping to have trial type on the x-axis. This is why I like to have trial type as words in my table as well as its numeric representation. I like to use the words in the plot, and you have to use the numeric representation when you're creating the dependent variable. So along the x-axis will represent trial type, and along the y-axis will represent the reaction time. And a violin plot is a decent way to have a look at this. Here we are. And you might look at this with a box plot on top as well. Maybe make the width a little bit smaller. Okay, so this shows us what we expected. Our congruent trials are faster than our incongruent trials. They're about 50 milliseconds apart, and the grand average, the mean, is around 800. Now again, we can rerun this with different error. The only thing that changes here is this error term. And our values will change a little bit. Now that we've simulated data using the equation from the linear regression, now remember this equation, y, or our reaction time, our dependent variable, is just the sum of mu, the grand average, an effect. We only have one effect here, so no interaction there. That effect is, for this sort of categorical factor, our effect is the effect size multiplied by the effect coding of the category plus the error. Now we can analyze the data we simulated using the function lm. It takes the formula as the first argument. So this formula is the same as your data generating equation. Let's make a variable called myLM. In the LM function, we'll set up our equation. So our dependent variable in the DAT table is going to be RT. And then we need this tilde, the wavy line. It means that's going to be predicted by, and we only have one predictor. We need to use the numerically coded version. So our predictor is the trial type. We're going to use the effect coded version of it, trial type.e. So that's our full equation. We don't need to include the error term. In a real data set, you won't know what the error is. It'll come from the subjects, but you won't have specified the error. And the linear model equation calculates or estimates the error for you. So we omit that in the equation. The other thing the linear model function needs to know is, where are we getting this data from? And we're getting it from the table called DAT. And we can run this quickly. And then to see what it looks like, use the summary function to print out a summary of my LM. So what the summary tells us, we're going to focus on this table right here, the coefficients table. It gives us an intercept value. This intercept value should be really close to whatever you set mu to, the grand average. And the p-value here just tells you whether or not it's significantly different from zero. And yes, 800 milliseconds is extremely significantly different from zero, and we don't really care about that. What we care about mostly is the trial type. Is there a difference between the two trial types? The estimate gives you how many milliseconds on average is the difference in this data set between the two trial types. So we built in a 50 millisecond difference, but because of random error that might go up or down from instance to instance, and here it's 34. But the linear model tells us that at least at a p-value, a critical alpha of 0.05, this would be significant. If we run this again, have a different data set, we can run our analysis again. So we can see our intercept is close to mu, and our trial type is again relatively close to 50. We can go back here and change mu, say to 600, and let's make our effect bigger, 100. So redefine this, run that again, and have a quick look. And yes, that looks about right. And then rerun the linear model. Now our intercept is back down to 600. And our estimate is extremely close to what we had set.